This kid is a straight-up monster. Take a look at the face of a 10-year-old English girl named Mary Bell. You would never believe the evil that she is capable of by just her appearance. On May 25, 1968, less than a year after this photo was taken, she took the life of a 4-year-old boy named Martin Brown, one day before her 11th birthday. After he was discovered, Bell and a friend gleefully told the boy's aunt that a body had been found and that it was probably Martin. They also went to the boy's house and asked his mother to see him in his coffin. A few months later, on July 31st, a 3-year-old boy named Brian Howe was found deceased in a vacant house. Someone had suffocated him, poked at him with a pair of scissors found at the scene, and carved an M into his stomach. Once again, Mary treated the boy's family horrifically, laughing as his coffin went by during his funeral procession. She was eventually arrested and found guilty of 2 counts of manslaughter in December of 1968. She would stay in prison until 1980, when she was released with a new identity. What drove young Mary to commit these horrific crimes? Was she simply born evil? Her childhood was certainly not a pleasant one, and the trauma and chemical damage inflicted on her by her mother must have played a significant role. She was born on May 26, 1957 in Corbridge, England. Her mother, Elizabeth Betty McCricket, was a well-known woman of the night who often traveled for her work. She had only been 17 when her second child Mary had been born, and it is said that she shrieked, "Get that thing away from me," when presented with her newborn daughter. Shortly after the birth, Betty married a violent alcoholic named William Bell, who had a rap sheet a mile long, and it is unsure as to whether he was the girl's biological father. Adding to the confusion is the fact that Betty's children were told to call him uncle to avoid losing their welfare benefits. The family lived in a dingy house in Newcastle, England. When her mother would leave town on business, Mary and her older sister were left with William, who often drank and mistreated them. Things were no better when their mother was home, and Betty seemed to have a particular dislike for Mary. In one case, she tried to give Mary away to a woman who had attempted to adopt a child but was found unsuitable due to mental instability. Mary's sister had to go retrieve her. There were other incidents as well, such as what neighbors were told was an accidental fall from a window and a near-fatal overdose on pills, resulting in Mary needing to get her stomach pumped. A friend of Mary's, as well as the girl herself, would say that she had gotten what they called candies from Betty Bell. This was not the first time that Mary had gotten her hands on dangerous medications, with the first incident occurring when she was just a year old. One can only imagine what effect this might have had on her brain development. Betty seemed to enjoy the attention that she got related to her daughter's accidents, leading some to believe that she suffered from what used to be called Munchausen by proxy syndrome, and which is now referred to as factitious disorder imposed on others. People afflicted with this condition often sabotage, poison, or feign illness of those in their care, then bask in the attention that it draws. There are many famous examples of this condition, and it has even made its way into popular culture in the Eminem song "Cleaning Out My Closet." One of the lyrics highlights this and even references the disorder by name. "Going through public housing systems, victim of Munchausen syndrome, my whole life I was made to believe I was sick when I wasn't." After Betty's reaction to the birth of Mary, we can only assume that there were significant levels of emotional abuse throughout her daughter's life. But what was even worse than the physical mistreatment and exposure to dangerous chemicals was what her mother is said to have started doing when Mary was as young as 4 years old. Betty was a specific variety of woman of the night, the kind that is hired to inflict pain and dominate the client. She soon saw an opportunity to supplement her own income by letting clients do things to her daughter, even joining in on some occasions, tying Mary up and blindfolding her before forcing her to perform disgusting services for her clients. This may be one of the most horrific acts of evil that I can imagine, and the clients and mother should have suffered the worst punishment possible if true. At school, Mary understandably acted out and earned a reputation as disruptive. At least one report says that she verbally expressed a desire to hurt people, but she was also known as a liar, so the statement was not taken seriously. She had a friend that she would get into trouble with named Norma Bell, who was 2 years older than Mary, and though they shared a last name, they were not related in any way. In 1968, things got violent. The first known incident occurred on May 11th. Mary and Norma were playing on top of an old air raid shelter with a 3-year-old boy. When he fell from the structure, everyone assumed it was just an accident. But the very next day, the parents of 3 girls came forward to police saying that they had been choked by Mary. Aside from a stern talking to, Mary was not punished, and she continued to escalate her behavior until she crossed the line from simply injuring a child to homicide. The area of Newcastle that Mary lived in was undergoing a series of major renovations. Old buildings were being torn down so that new ones could be built. The result was that at any given time, the kids could find vacant structures and mountains of rubble, and of course, they played on both. Mary would use a vacant lot to conceal her next crime. She lured a 4-year-old boy named Martin Brown into an empty house on May 25, 1968. In this case, she acted alone for whatever reason, and Norma is believed not to have participated. Martin was last seen around 3:15 p.m. Only 15 minutes later, three boys exploring the vacant house found him laying motionless in an upstairs bedroom, with blood and spit trailing from his mouth. They immediately ran to find adults, and some nearby construction workers rushed to try to help, but they were too late. As the boys who had found him panicked over what they had seen, Mary came walking up with Norma to show her what she had done. As the construction workers tried their best to revive Martin, the two leering girls stuck their heads around the corner into the bedroom to see what was going on. They were quickly shooed out of the house, and so they went to Martin's aunt's house instead nearby. Mary told the woman that one of her nephews had had an accident, and that they thought it was Martin, but could not be sure due to him being covered in blood. Police could not identify exactly what had taken the boy's life initially. There were no signs of violence because Mary's grip had not been strong enough to leave marks, but nearby was a bottle of aspirin, and so his passing was marked as an accidental overdose, and there was no further investigation. The people of Newcastle protested what they saw as dangerous conditions that their children were forced to play in, and indeed the construction project presented danger, though the actual cause of the tragedy was much more insidious, hidden in a small child who no one could imagine was capable of such evil. Mary made no effort to act upset over the tragedy, and she and Norma would harass Martin's aunt, asking if she missed Martin and whether she cried over him. These questions were asked with a grin and giggles, which was deeply unsettling. They did not limit themselves to the aunt either. They went to Martin's home and asked his mother to see him. When they were told that he was deceased, Mary and Norma giggled and said that they knew, and they were asking to see him in his coffin. Mary and Norma committed other crimes in addition to terrorizing the other kids as well, including breaking in and vandalizing a nursery school. The supplies had been strewn around the room and cleaning liquids dumped out, but there were also notes left behind. These notes claimed credit for the passing of Martin, and to paraphrase one, it said that the author took lives so that they could come back. Who knows where they got the idea for this creepy statement? Other notes were more vulgar, but were written off by police as a twisted joke. The nursery school installed an alarm system, otherwise there was not much that they could do since there was little evidence to determine who had broken in. Just days later, on May 31st, the alarm system went off, and when police arrived, they found Mary and Norma lurking outside. Though the girls denied breaking in, they were cited and released into their parents' custody, set to appear in juvenile court at a later date. There are other reports saying that Mary would openly claim credit for taking Martin's life to the other kids, pointing at the house where he was found and declaring that she had done it. In late July, Mary's need to brag about her crimes led her to the home of the Howe family. Though she told them that she knew a secret about Norma that would put her friend away if she told, rather than claiming credit for herself. She described how Norma had wrapped her hands around Martin's throat and that he had collapsed afterwards. The Howe family was no doubt disturbed by this proclamation, though they likely did not believe Mary and thought that she was simply trying to process the loss of one of the neighborhood kids that she played with. They had no way of knowing that Mary was foreshadowing her next heinous act. Just days later, on July 31st, 1968, she and Norma lured 3-year-old Brian Howe into a vacant lot where he would later be found after he did not return home. Around 11 p.m., a police search found him laying between two concrete blocks in a vacant lot where the kids played. While there had been no signs of violence on the body of Martin Brown, this was not the case with Brian Howe. His attacker had made an attempt at hiding his remains, but he was still clearly visible under the grass and weeds, making it seem like a child had done it. His wounds were severe, with puncture marks on his thighs, and his private parts had been partially skinned. A pair of scissors was found nearby that had been used to poke at him and cut clumps of his hair off. There was also an M carved into his stomach with a razor blade. Further examination would indicate that the mark had initially been an N, but then someone had added a fourth line to convert it into an M. Of course, there was no way that anyone could claim what had happened was an accident, and an investigation was immediately underway. The local kids were interviewed and two in particular stood out to police. Mary seemed secretive and disconnected from the seriousness of what had happened, while Norma grinned openly, acting as if it was all a big joke. As the investigation tightened on the two girls, Mary suddenly came up with a new story. She said that she had seen an 8-year-old from the neighborhood playing with Brian, and that he had hit the 3-year-old. She also said that the 8-year-old had been playing with a pair of scissors, which she described in great detail. The only issue with her story is that the boy she implicated had not been in the area at the time of the crime, meaning that she was lying and was likely present when Brian's life was taken at the very least. Cracks were beginning to form in the stories of the two girls, and Norma broke down, placing the blame squarely on Mary. She claimed that Mary had taken her to see what she had done to Brian, but when the 11-year-old was brought in, she refused to admit anything. Police said that it was as if she thought that she was in a cops and robbers movie. Despite their suspicions, Mary was allowed to go home around 3:30 a.m. after intense questioning. On the day of Brian's funeral, his coffin was carried out of his family's home, and right outside was Mary, laughing and rubbing her hands together like a movie villain. The detective in the case was a man named James Dobson, and he had made a point of monitoring his two suspects during the somber procession. He would say that when he saw Mary's glee, he knew that she had committed the homicide and that he could not wait another day or she might do it again. She was brought back into the station, and it seemed that Mary knew the game was up, though she still tried to deflect the blame onto Norma. After her friend had told on her, she attempted to do the same and gave a detailed confession that described how Norma had done it. This ploy was not successful, and she was arrested and charged with homicide, as was Norma. While the pair was incarcerated at the Newcastle West End Police Station, investigators began to look into the case of Martin Brown. They had heard of Mary's behavior after the horrible event that was very similar to how she acted after the Brian Howe homicide. The notes that the girls had left behind in the nursery school were matched to their handwriting and counted against them, and they were charged with a second homicide. The trial began on December 5, 1968. A court psychologist would describe Mary as a psychopath, likely because he had no idea what went on when she was at home, since Mary had been instructed by her mother not to talk about it, especially with authorities. Had she been open about her home life, she might have been treated with some leniency. But because she had not, all the court would see was her acts of evil and none of the underlying trauma. There was little doubt that Mary was responsible for Brian Howe's passing, and the prosecutor asserted that the same person was responsible for Martin Brown as well. Mary sat stone-faced as the evidence was presented. Meanwhile, her mother, Betty, wailed and sobbed in the audience, drawing as much attention to herself as possible. Norma, on the other hand, reacted as one might expect a child to act when presented with such horrors, and generally presented herself as a much more sympathetic character. She placed the blame squarely on Mary and described various statements and acts of violence that implicated her more and more. In the prosecution's closing argument, he described Mary as a fiend and said that Norma was a victim with a simple mind who had been compelled to accompany her manipulative friend. While the defense did allude to the horrific things that Mary had gone through at home, they were not successful in avoiding a conviction for 2 counts of manslaughter. Norma avoided a conviction but would later be sentenced to 3 years probation for breaking and entering charges related to the vandalism of the nursery school. Mary was sentenced to detention for life, but as we know, this does not exactly mean what it sounds like in most countries. While she was incarcerated, her mother once again manipulated the situation to her own advantage, presenting herself as the biggest victim. Betty would also convince her daughter to write poems that she could sell to the press. Mary would spend time at various institutions and would claim that she had been assaulted by a male staff member at 13 years old while she was at the Red Bank juvenile facility. Her story was deemed not credible, though there were staffing changes after the allegations. This is worrisome considering her childhood, and it would have reinforced her distrust of authority figures if what she had described actually happened. In September of 1977, while incarcerated at the Moore Court open prison, Mary escaped with another inmate named Annette Priest. They would spend several days in Blackpool with 2 young men, staying in various hotels and seeing the sights. Despite dyeing her hair blonde, Mary was rearrested on September 13th in Derbyshire, while Annette was arrested shortly after in Leeds. The pair received only a slap on the wrist for the escape, losing privileges for less than a month. Starting in 1976, Mary began applying for parole, though she was initially denied. However, in June of 1979, she was moved to the Askham Grange Women's Prison in preparation for her release, which was scheduled for the following year. While incarcerated, Mary had begun taking classes to become a secretary, and in November of 1979, she started working while still in prison, preparing for her re-entry into society. Mary Bell was released from prison in May of 1980 at 23 years old with a new identity after less than 12 years behind bars. She is said to have visited her hometown and even lived there for a while, to the dismay of residents, many of whom wanted her to spend her life in prison. Ironically, Mary had a daughter who was born on May 25, 1984, 16 years to the day after she took Martin Brown's life. There was, of course, considerable resentment against Mary, and so her identity was legally protected. While initially this protection was meant to expire, she got it extended for the life of her and her daughter in 2003, making it illegal for anyone to divulge her identity or whereabouts. The court order protecting her anonymity was also given to her granddaughter when she was born in 2009. She would participate in interviews for a book in 1998, which is where much of what we know about her childhood comes from. Though she acknowledges that her home life was horrific, she makes no excuses for what she did. As of January 2024, Mary Bell is still alive, though her location and the name that she goes by is unknown.